is a traditional Lakota Sioux Native American prayer that goes like this. I carry with me the power of creation, but those things over which I have no control will enable me to see beyond myself and become truly one with all life here in my home. I will become one with my power again, and I will be all that I can be. And I found out about that prayer several years ago, and I've kind of kept it in the back of my mind. And although it's not in the book, I think it lays a good foundation for talking about the topic of character, which is what the book is. And let's just kind of look at this to kind of set the foundation and kind of blend everybody together here. I carry with me the power of creation. Each one of us has the power within us, the imagination and the creativity to go out and be and do anything that we want to be. But those things over which I have no control will enable me to see beyond myself. Faith. Having faith in those things that we cannot see and just going forward anyways. And become truly one with all life here in my home. Here in my home, our bodies, to traditional Native American teachings, are our home, are our vessel of our soul, and we carry everything with us here in our home. I will become one with my power again, and I will see all that I am. You know, we can stray, we can forget about things, but if we always remember that, I will become one with my power again, and I will be and see all that I am. We can come back to that. We can harness that internal power in time and continue to move on into new adventures. The book is called Branding Your Character. And this has been an 8-year journey that's finally over. So for those of you that are writing, don't give up. Just continue plugging away a little bit at a time, because eventually it will come to fruition. And I saw the original material that I was collecting several years ago for this book, and at that time I had the idea that I was going to write this book with the background of more of a religious and spiritual aspect to it. Because, you know, really, when you talk about character and when you think about character, when you read about it, most every other book that's on this subject out there is in some religious context about that. And I was working away, and didn't feel right with some things. I let it go first, you know, 6 months or so, and then I'd come back to it, work on it again. And nothing really felt right with it. And then all of a sudden, about 2 years ago, I had this vision, and again, sleeping on things really does help. You know, sometimes in the middle of the night, those just little sparks of inspiration come to us. And that spark of inspiration for me for this book was to get away from that religious, spiritual aspect of the book and make it more of a practical, everyday book that more people will read, but also to put a little business spin on it. Because, you know, when we put dollars and cents to something, sometimes it sticks a little bit better. You know, we can sit and talk all about philosophy and, you know, all these great ideas, but sometimes unless we can really sit down and put some hardcore facts to it and a price tag to it, then we just kind of let it go. So when that happened, all of a sudden the book just started falling into place. And I finished most of it about a year ago. And was very happy with the way that it turned out. And I had a friend of mine that owned a publishing company that was going to publish the book for me. And that didn't work out. You know, we have people that promise us things and, you know, say that are going to do things for us, and then when the time comes, what?
Nothing.
Nothing. You know, they don't follow through with things, and so that actually happened to me. And when I look at back now, it was the best thing that ever happened. Because one of my good friends and one of my mentors for years in the writing, in getting started in writing, is a guy by the name of John Turbin, who was a retired Catholic priest, who was one of the top authors in Christian spirituality books. Really good friend of mine. I think he's written 20-some books that are translated in about 15 different languages all over the world. And I said, John, what would you do? He said, Ken, if I had to start my career all over again, I'd have published my first book myself from the beginning. He said, because writing a book is this much work, and selling and marketing it is this much work. And it doesn't matter if you go through a mainstream publishing company or if you publish it yourself, you still have to do the same amount of work. Publishing companies do not sell books for you. You still have to go out and sell the books. So I had that in the back of my mind, and when this other project didn't come to fruition, it's like, okay, I'm going to do it. So I did. I went out and I started Personal Dynamics Publishing, went through all the steps to set it up as a full corporation that's recognized worldwide in the publishing industry. I have all the little ISBN numbers and all those little codes that you need to have to be a publishing company and to sell a book. And I did that. And I thought, okay, now, where am I going to come up with $10,000, you know, to buy all these books, and whose garage am I going to store them in? And then, about a year ago, there's been a shift in the publishing business. Publishing done today is not like what it was years ago. Everything now is digital. So you don't have to go out and buy thousands and thousands of copies of a book at a time. You can buy one, or you could buy two, or you can buy 2,000, however you want. They print them as they're ordered. So there's no more storing books in a garage in cases. And then typically what happens when you write a book, even though you proofread it and proofread it and have a dozen other people proofread it, once it comes out in print, guess what? Oh, there's a mistake on page 13 and another one on page 52. That's now fixed. Because with digital publishing, if you find a mistake, you can correct it, re-upload that file, and the next time that you order another batch of books, it's now corrected. So there's no more cases of spoiled books anymore. So with those changes in the publishing industry, I really harnessed all of that and took full use of all of that. So for those of you that are here in the audience that are really interested in working on a book or have one started, I know Camille wants to have us get together as a whole little group and talk about that because there's a lot of opportunities nowadays that you may not be aware of. And even if you want to write and publish a book that's your story or your family's story so that you can leave it for the generations that come after, you can do that now, where you didn't have that luxury before. So there are some great things happening and changing in the publishing industry. So the book then has more of a business and a personal slant than a religious and spiritual slant. And let's go through a few things here. Chapter 1's title is called A Man's Character is His Fate. And that's how we start out the book. People grow through experience if they meet life honestly and courageously. This is how character is built. A great quote by Eleanor Roosevelt. And in Chapter 1, I lay the foundation of what character is and how important it is for you as an individual, how important it is for you as a parent to be a role model and leave that to your kids. And we also talk on the flip side, everything that's going on in the world today. I really feel sorry for some of these younger kids because there's really not that many role models left for them anymore. Because when we look at the politicians and we look at the entertainers and we look at sports celebrities, it's all sex, it's corruption, it's greed. And, you know, our youth today don't have that many role models to follow right now. So hopefully by the end of this book, I'm going to empower some of you to go out and make some changes, not only in your life, but also in those that are around you. I use the analogy of a pie and baking a pie in chapter one. You know, our character is like that pie. It takes several ingredients to make a pie, but not all of those ingredients are in equal proportion. So we have a lot of flour, a lot of fruit, and maybe a pinch of salt that goes into the batter to make that pie. And then we have to bake it. We're in the oven, right? And it has to cook and bubble and simmer under high, high heat before that pie then becomes something delicious that we can eat. And character is the same way. We have a little bit of imagination, a lot of faith, a little bit of purpose, and a lot of works that goes behind that, that then have to be baked in the world around us, in life, before your character can end up being the final product of how and what you want it to be. Chapter 2, we look at a little bit of the business side of it. Leverage your brand. And we talk about branding. And branding is a big term that's used every day in the business and corporate world. People are branding everything nowadays. William A. Ward said, "Wise are those who learn that the bottom line doesn't always have to be their top priority." Which basically means if you're in business, don't worry about all the greed and the money. Worry about servicing and helping and being service of to others that are around you. And when you focus on that, then guess what? The money starts coming then. The more people that you can serve and the more of service that you can be to other people, the more benefits, the more notoriety, and the more financial surprises that end up coming to you as well. And there's actually a corporation out there, it's called Interbrand, and they do a case study every year. And they look at corporations and products, and they determined brand valuations for products that are out there. Coca-Cola is and has been for the last umpteen years the number one recognized brand in the world. The statistics that I used in the book were from 2010, and those are the dollar values in parentheses over there. So in the book, in 2010, the brand name and the brand recognition of Coca-Cola was worth $70.5 billion. That's B, billion with a B, billion dollars. That's just for the name Coca-Cola. That's just for their brand. That has nothing to do with their factories, their raw ingredients, the products that they have, anything. That's just for the value of the name Coca-Cola. The new statistics are out for 2011, and it went up to $71.9 billion for 2011. That's how much in 1 year just the name and the brand recognition has grown for Coca-Cola. In 2011 now, the second brand recognition is for IBM. And that's their dollar values there in billions of dollars. And the third one in the world is Microsoft. And actually, Microsoft went down a little bit this year by a few million dollars. But it still stayed in number three position from 2010 to 2011. And when we talk about that aspect of branding, you know, branding has been around for years and years and years, all the way back to the early slave trades when people used to brand their slaves as property and to know who owns that slave. It's still done today in the farming communities for branding cattle. Big ranches will burn on the hide of a cow or a horse the brand of who owns that cow. And the interesting thing will happen. What happens if a cow gets loose and strays, like, into the neighbor's yard? And you see the brand on the butt of that cow? What are you going to do if you have a really good relation with your neighbors? You're going to call them up and, you know, tell them to, hey, your cow's out, come get your cow. What if your neighbor is not too nice to you and not too nice to the neighborhood and is probably, you know, kind of a rotten person? What are you going to do? You're going to put the cow in your freezer. So branding and brand recognition has been around for years. The medieval time in castles, when you tour all through England and that, through the castles, the tapestries with the crest, the family crest and all of that, that is also a brand for branding your family and your family's reputation. It's further down on this list as far as worldwide brands go, but what's one of the most recognizable fast food brands that's in the United States and around the world?
McDonald's.
The Golden Arches, the M. So when you take that business spin to it and start to applying those principles to us as a person, now we kind of have something to grasp onto, and it kind of makes it more relatable to us in today's business world and the economy. And there's a lot of emotions. A brand can elicit emotions. In a moment, I'm going to pop up here a picture. And when I pop up that picture, I want you to flash back to when you use that product either on yourself or on somebody. And also think about the memories that it brings back that come to you. And also, I'll bet you'll be able to smell it as well. Jackson's baby powder.
Oh yeah.
What? Clean? Fresh, safe, secure, helping lots of little babies and little people all around the world. Real good positive brand recognition that will bring back some memories for you guys as well. And that's what a brand does. A brand will elicit those emotions and those memories. It could be good, or it could be not so good, depending on your experiences that you've had with that person, that product, or that service. I also talk in chapter 2-2, like Naomi has a service business and Bobby has a service business. It's just as important to brand your service as it is to brand a product in business. Just as so, it's as important to brand you as a person. There's a lot of you in here that have your own businesses, and there's a fine line when you're in business for yourself. What hat do I have on, and what role am I playing? Am I the company brand, or am I my personal brand? And sometimes those lines can get pretty hazy. And when you do have a small business like that, in a service business like Naomi does, you know, you're it. You are the face of your company. You are it. So you are that brand. Whenever you go out to the grocery store, wherever you go out, you know, shopping in the mall, you're always having to carry that brand with you because people recognize you with that. Just like wherever Camille goes, it's always, there she is, Miss Gateway Arts Foundation. You know, that's a good positive brand that she carries with her, and she holds that very well. In chapter 3, we talk about individuality and how important it is to be an individual and not to follow the herd and not to follow the masses. Because when people are brought together and are just thrown together in a herd, there is no sense of individuality. There is no sense of empowerment. There's no sense of growth or development for the people then as well. Again, he said, be the change you wish to see. Standing up and being an individual and standing your ground is probably one of the most powerful things that you can do. All change that has been done in history has started from an individual who has stood up, stood their ground, and said, no, this is the way that it needs to be, not what was going on here. We've seen that in our lifetime in many changes that have happened in society. Who do you think is probably the number one person, the poster child, if you will, for individuality that made a stand and changed the world from that one issue that she did?
Rosa Parks.
Rosa Parks. There she is right there. December 1st, 1955, her saying, no, I'm not sitting there, changed the world. And that's the power that we as an individual have. It's one of the problems, though, that we talk about in the book with our current public education system. Where is that sense of individuality in our public education system? There is none. There is none. So it really, it's really hurting the kids today because they have no sense of purpose to be able to have their own sense of self and their own sense of identity. On page 48 of the book, there is a quote by Woodrow Wilson, who was our 28th president of the United States. I'm going to read these words and listen to them. But know that these words were written in the 1914. Just see how pertinent they are today. The law tries nowadays to deal with men in groups and companies, to punish them as corporate wholes. It is an idle undertaking. It will never be successfully accomplished. The only responsibility to which human society has ever responded or ever will respond is the responsibility of the individual. The law must find the individual in the modern corporation and apply its demands and its punishments to him if we are to check any of the vital abuses which now trouble the business world. You may pile fines ever so high in the public treasury, and corporations will still continue to do things that they should not do unless you check them by taking hold of individuals who are ultimately responsible for their policy. Enron, BP oil spill, Bernie Madoff, all of those. Just as important today, 100 years later, as when he wrote those initial words. The sad part to this is with our politicians and our business leaders, we've gone 100 years and haven't learned anything. Individuality is really, really important when it comes to developing yourself and your character identity. Chapter 4, I talk about purpose. The purpose of life is a life of purpose. And this is where that religious barrier gets fuzzy, because there's a lot of religious books that talk about purpose and character blend them together and say that if you believe in those really strict religious teachings, that you are put here to do this purpose and this job and that's it. And that's fine if that's what your religion is. I, on the other hand, which we talk about in the book, tend to have a little bit more of a open spiritual and esoteric view of it. I say that human beings are the only creatures that are endowed with both free will and personal responsibility. We have the free will to pick and choose and do what we want to do and learn and grow. But we also have the personal responsibility to hold ourselves accountable to our actions and what we decide to do, both good and bad. So, do you want that free will to grow and learn and develop and grow into somebody that's going to help a lot of people? Or are you going to use that same free will and go out and, you know, murder people or rob people or, you know, do that? It's your choice. But you have to know that you have to have the personal responsibility then to accept the outcome of that. So if you're going to do good, then you're going to get the financial, you know, money that's going to be coming in, the growth of the business, the friends, the relationships, and all of that. But if you decide to go out and kill somebody or rob a store, then you're going to have to take those consequences of sitting in jail. Free will and personal responsibility. Great minds have purposes, others have wishes. You know, if we're going to take a trip around the world, we have to have a purpose. We have to have our road map. And your purpose is your road map. Where do you want to go and what do you want to do? You can both have short-term goals and you can have long-term goals as well. And that's our purpose. And there's a great play, musical, that was here in Vegas for a few years and it's on Broadway. And although it has some rather racy adult content to it, actually the whole underlying message of that play is all about purpose. So when you think about that, we can find good quality character development and good lessons in a lot of different areas that are out there. We just have to look for them. And it's the musical Avenue Q. And that's what purpose does. It lights that fire. And that's the message. Make sure that you find your purpose before it's too late. Don't wait till the final days of your life to determine what your purpose is. Start young. Start developing those purpose tracks and avenues and roadmap in the kids that are around you as well. So chapter 4 talks all about purpose. I'm going to jump ahead to chapter 6. Chapter 6 talks about friends. You know, friends come and go, but enemies accumulate, you know? JFK said, forgive your enemies, but never forget their names. You know, some good teachings and some good lessons there. And, you know, when you think about it, when you look around this room, there's a lot of us in this room that have really good friendships that have gone back several years and some new friendships. And that's really how you need to value your life, is look around you, not how much money that you have in your bank account, but how many friends do you have around you that you can call on whenever you're in need. That really depends and tells the story of how good of a person you are. Even the dogs and cats, you know, kind of get together there and are friends together. And there's all kinds of friends, and we talk about that in chapter 6. There's different types of friendships. We have romantic friendships, people that we're interested in that way. We have utility friendships. You know, maybe you're just friends with somebody because you're able to get a ride to work with them every day. Or maybe, you know, you keep on a friendship with this person because you're in business together. But there's other friendship types of friendships, like social friendships, and that those are the ones that we choose that we want to have in our lives, you know, that really mean something the most to us, that both people benefit. And you can't have a friend relationship if it's always just one-sided. If you're the one that's always having to give and give and give when you're with this person, guess what? When you see their name on caller ID, what happens? Oh no, I'm not talking about that. They suck your energy out of you. You know? They do. So, you know, if you want to be a friend, you have to be a good friend. You have to be a friend if you want a friend. And it's a reciprocal, it's a two-way street. There's some interesting research that I talk about in the book. And there's a research study that I quote in the book. There was a study done a couple years ago over in the Netherlands by a sociologist over there that found that we lose half of our friends every 7 years. That there's like a cycle that we go through. About every 7 years, you'll renew your friendships. You'll drop old ones and you'll gain new ones. You know, when you really think about that, it's true, because what? You might move, so you're going to get new friends, you're going to leave those other ones behind. You might start a new job, you're going to do the same thing. You might get involved in a new club, new social club, or you just might get tired of that person after a while. I had a friend back in Michigan, we were in business together, and we made a lot of money together, but I could not stand her. She was obnoxious and rude and belligerent to, you know, to me and everybody else. But I paid the price because I was making so much money with her. As soon as that business arrangement ended, the next month it was bye-bye. And I haven't seen her, talked to her, or done anything in over a year. And you know what? I feel so much better. So know that, you know, that we grow and we develop, and we can have the choice to do that. There's also a new term that was coined a few years ago called a frenemy. You know, and that's kind of a little bit of both. They're a friend, but they're an enemy. We have to keep them around for some reason, so we call them a frenemy. And I talk about that in the book too. So. There's that saying too, you know, we're judged by the friends and the company that we keep. You know, and look around. If you really want to grow and develop your character, or on the other hand, if you have kids and grandkids, look at the crowd they're hanging around with, because they're the ones that are forming the character of your kids. So you really need to, you know, to look into that, and as a parent or a grandparent, you know, maybe some intervention type things might have to come into play. We jump ahead to chapter 8. Chapter 8 talks about faith. And although I said this wasn't a religious talk, or this book wasn't built on a religious sense, I did have to throw in a whole chapter on faith, because, you know, without faith, a lot of stuff wouldn't happen. We have to have the faith in ourselves and the faith in those around us to be able to move forward in life. We have to have that confidence and that faith in our abilities that we're going to do the right thing and we're going to do what's right not only for us but for those that are around us. Feed your faith and your fears will starve to death. You know, faith is that power that makes us get out there and step out of our comfort zone, step out of that little box, and do things that maybe we wouldn't have done. And that's when we grow and develop as a person. You know, doubt and faith are on the same spectrum. They're just on different ends. You know, good and evil, you can replace whatever you want. It's a spectrum. And it just depends on what end of the spectrum are you living. And, you know, we can fluctuate back and forth. I mean, there's some things, you know, if we're going to go buy a car from a used car salesman, then we're probably going to be down here on the doubt side, right? But then if we're going to do something for Gateway Arts Foundation, who does such good stuff for me, then we're going to be over here on the positive side of faith. But, you know, most of us, you know, kind of hover back and forth somewhere here in the middle, which is a good thing. But the more that we can live our lives more on that spectrum towards the faith side than the doubt side, the better off we're going to be. The other term that fits in here good with this would be, you know, optimist and pessimist. Doubt and faith, same terminology that fits in there. My friend John Kirvin, in his books, I actually quoted him on page 124 in the book, and he kind of talks about the faith the way that I want, not in a strictly religious sense, but more in an esoteric spiritual sense. He says, faith is not a simple profession of what you accept as true, not something stirred up in moments of grandeur or terror, not a spiritual grace note to an ordinary life, not a spiritual grand loyalty. Faith is something else again. It's another way of knowing what is most familiar to us, and at the same time, coming to know a world beyond the familiar. Beyond everything that can be reached by our mind and senses. It is what you do, how you respond in the face of unfathomable mystery that lies at the core of everything we are, of everything we experience. Faith is our submission to, our embrace of, the unknowable as the cornerstone of our lives. And that's the kind of faith that I wanted to really project in this book. You know, moving forward, having that faith, knowing that we're here to do good and to help others, and that everything else will come to us in the due time that it's supposed to. And that's a hard lesson right there, you know, because we want it now. Instant gratification, always, always, always. But when you grow and you develop of a person with character traits, you learn that delayed gratification is just as good and actually more powerful and more beneficial for us than anything of the instant gratification type. You know, there was a story of when Jay and Barry wrote the story about Tinkerbell flying, and when the kids would read that story, there was a lot of kids that were getting hurt because they had the faith. They were so engrossed in the words that he wrote in that book that the kids would go out, they'd jump off of, you know, their porches, they'd jump off their beds, they'd think that they could fly because, you know, kids have that sense of faith when they're born. And it's as we grow and develop, it's kind of beaten out of us, if you will. That is why he had to rewrite the story. And in order for the kids to fly in the story, they needed what? Tinkerbell's fairy dust in order to fly. He had to do that so that the kids would quit hurting themselves because they had such the inherent faith that they wanted to get out there and fly themselves. So that's what we talk about in chapter 8 as far as faith. In chapter 9, I kind of wrap everything up and talk about how character is a victory and not a gift. Your character is not something that you should expect. It's something that you earn and it's developed over time. My good friend Jennifer that wrote the foreword to the book, Naomi knows her and Michael, you guys know her. She wrote the foreword to the book and she's a psychotherapist. And she reminded me as we were working on this book, and she wrote the foreword for me, that, you know, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. When she looks at the psychosis of the kids that come to see her, all she's got to do is turn around and look at the parents. You know, she's like, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. You know, and she sees a lot of that on the negative side. But I say that to you to empower you to work with your kids, to work with your grandkids, to work with those that are around you every day so that you can instill some of those qualities around them, and that hopefully your apple will fall close to your tree and empower those that are close to you. There is an interesting, I call it more of a rock opera, Trans-Siberian Orchestra. How many people are familiar with TSO? They have a whole performance called the Beethoven's Last Night. Have you seen it or heard it? They did it here in Vegas about five years ago. And there's a song in there that I talk about in the book that kind of wraps up the whole talk about character in chapter 9. And some of the words of the song go like this. And who would have thought that my fate it would conjure this twist in the road on which I have wandered, each vision and dream now completely dismembered, to give one's whole life and find nothing's remembered. The whole premise of Beethoven's Last Night, it's the last night in Beethoven's life where he actually flashes back in his life and sees what all has happened in his life and what hasn't happened, the good and the bad and all of that. And he really brings home this message that character is a victory, not a gift. We have to earn it. And it's never too late to start building and to start doing what we need to do. And what good is a life that leaves nothing behind, not a thought or a dream that might echo in time? The years and the hours, the seconds and minutes, and everything that my life has placed in it, betrayed. Betrayed is the name of the song. Don't betray yourself by not empowering yourself and growing and developing your character traits, not only in yourself, but those people that are around you. At the end of the book, I talk about character in action, and we talk about three different examples of different things where we can really see character in action. And one of them, I mentioned and talk about is Liza Minnelli. Carrie, Leo, Carrie and I have had the pleasure of having dinner with Liza Minnelli. And I use her example as a good one, especially when we're talking about the arts here in Las Vegas. It used to be etiquette that when a big performer like her came into town, that after their performance, about 2 o'clock in the morning, they would do a whole other show for free for all the other performers on the strip and invite them. Because when the entertainers and performers were working every day on the strip, they couldn't get out and see anything because they were always working. So it used to be etiquette that about 2 o'clock in the morning, some of these performers would come and do these extra special shows. It was also a good chance for them to try out new jokes, try a new song, a new dance routine, or something like that. But it was giving back to your community and giving back to the entertainment community. I've lived here in Vegas for 9 years now, along with Chuck and Diana back there. I'm part of the media too, and go to a lot of press events and do a lot of shows and that. And I have to tell you that in my 9 years here, Liza Minnelli is still the only person that comes into town that will do free shows like that for the other entertainers at 2 o'clock in the morning. Everybody else, No, not anymore. So, when you read things that are sensationalized in, you know, the gossip magazines and the gossip columns and all of that kind of stuff, don't always take that as the truth. You know, really take time to know somebody, to meet them, to learn about them, before you really believe everything that you read in some of those stories. Because there's been a lot of stuff written, you know, about lies and about a lot of people that really aren't truthful. They're just there to sell newspapers or books or magazines. And when you really get to know a person and really get to see who they are as far as their character and their identity and what they do to give back to those that are around them, you have a totally new appreciation for people. So she's just one, and there's two other great examples that I talk about in the book too. This is not part of the book, but I just got it a couple weeks ago. This has been going around the internet. How many people have been emailed this Charles Schultz philosophy that's been going around? I think it's been going around and around and around. You know, and I've probably seen it 10 or 15 times and just hit delete, but all of a sudden, 2 weeks ago, this really hit home. And it's so pertinent to the discussion of character and how we talk about things with the book. There's a whole long list, but there are just three of them here on the slide. Name the last five winners of the Miss America pageant. Name 10 people who have won the Nobel or the Pulitzer Prize. No. Name the last six Academy Award winners for the best actor or actress. No. Oh, this is big news. This is big notoriety. This is publicity. This is everything, isn't it? No. List a few teachers who aided your journey through school.
Yep.
Name five people who have taught you something worthwhile. Name three friends who have helped you through a difficult time. This is where character comes into play. You want to be one of these people that other people think about you and remember about you. Not the flashy, star-studded awards or notoriety that may come in the newspaper. This is where it really makes a difference. The fine line. Actually, somebody just posted that on my Facebook wall the other day by Deepak Chopra. I am here to serve. I am here to inspire. I am here to love. I am here to live my truth, your truth with character. I close the book with this author unknown quote. Watch your thoughts, they become your words. Watch your words, they become your actions. Watch your actions, they become habits. Watch your habits, they become character. Watch your character, for it becomes your destiny. This is your time, this is your moment that you can now take and move forward, not only in your life, but those that are around you. Thank you so much.
Joy of listening to this brilliant gentleman. I'd like to tell you a little bit about him. Because you won't say it by yourself. Kent is a human potential consultant in the areas of motivational sales and personal development, as of course we experience today. He has over 20 years of corporate and small business management experience. As an ordained minister, Ken has worked with many individuals along with group sessions and nonprofit organizations. He blends his corporate and management experience with his crisis counseling. What Ken had also failed to mention today is that he is a very, very well-known hypnotist. And I found myself sitting there thinking, I am so mesmerized by listening to him. Has he hypnotized me? His brilliance? No. What he has done is share his intellect and his knowledge with us, and I think that we will all definitely benefit by meeting this gentleman. Ken is going to be signing his book, and Bonnie is going to be his sales consultant for this effort. But before we're going to be on the patio because it's so beautiful this afternoon, and then I hope that you'll join us all for some light refreshments and wine and tea, etc. But does anybody have a question? There has to be a question.
I just want to say I read the book. It's fantastic. It's helped me with my bad habits, bad thought habits, whatever you want to say. You know, it taught me to think what you want and it'll be created for you, kind of thing. But these are also great gifts. And I'm immediately going to order 100 and send them to each CEO of every casino on the I'm not, but I'm going to afford wonderful gifts to you guys. So keep that in mind. Fabulous.
Is there anything that really gets you down? I mean, intellectually, you can deal with all of these things, but is there one area that gets to you?
As far as what? How do you? As a person that tries to live by all of this, and based on what you read about me in my past, my phone is always ringing. I mean, I always have people like, I need this. Can you help me with that? You know, it's like, as one of those people, it's really, you know, it gets to me after a while, and I...
I'm calling you back.
No, you just have to, find ways to not be overwhelmed and find ways that you allow that stress to relax you. You know, and one of the things here, you know, it's hanging out, you know, with you and Kathleen and with everybody, you know, us going out to dinner and us going having a drink or, you know, going to see Kathleen's show on the strip, you know, and laughing our butts off because laughter is such a great, healing tool. And just hanging around with friends and doing that's what really helps me. When all the other ones are overwhelming.
How do you say no? Because that's a question I want to ask. How do you say no to somebody without being that, because that's such a negative word, no.
It is.
Is there a way, can you give a suggestion?
That's a good question.
Because I've got three people now moving to Vegas this month. And I don't know if any of you are aware of it, but evidently I run Las Vegas.
No, I run Las Vegas. I think all of us that live here run Las Vegas in the eyes of those that,
and
you know,
if I can help them find a place to live, get a job, get a gig, you know, who's got their pizza. You know, I'm supposed to now
drop everything.
And so I feel like, just because when I say it out loud, I think it, what the hell have I done in here? That's a bad way to look at it. Yeah. You know, that's a compliment that they think I know so much because I do live here and I have been and I do know who has really good pizza. But
you know what I've done? I have so many people that come here like, where should I go? You know, what should I do? What should I see? I have actually put together a list. I have a list. Vegas fun things and activities to do. And here it is. I email it out to them. I'm hoping I'm done with it.
Maybe you could forward that.
So yeah, I mean, like, do it once in some form, and then it's there for mass distribution afterwards.
Yeah, we all need you to forward it.
I know building your character and everything here is really important, but what we forget are the small, and they call them random acts of kindness and things that, you know, a personal word or a gesture could have just changed the direction of somebody's life.
Right.
And I mean, we forget about that when we're going through our day-to-day journey. I mean, we're so sometimes focused on ourselves and trying to do everything for ourselves that we actually forget, you know, giving a dollar to this person or telling somebody they're beautiful. I mean, you could have just saved that person's life because their self-esteem could have been the worst on that day.
Yeah.
So I think, did you find it hard to keep that personal belief out of it?
I don't think I kept it out of it. I kept it, the kind of, as like an underlying foundation and kind of weed, you know, some of that through there. And trying to tell people that focus on what you do and how you do it. And there's a good chapter on works that I didn't even talk about that's in the book. It kind of talks about that too. Like here, Bobby and Mercedes. You guys, Bobby owns a hair salon. Mercedes is
one of the...
Mercedes, one of the stylists there. But, you know, we always, no matter where we go, cocktail parties, networking events, all that, what do? You know, or who are you? Oh, I'm an author, I'm an entertainer, I'm a writer, I'm a comedian.
Yeah.
We're too quick to brand ourselves with what we do versus who we are. And when you kind of make that shift and start thinking and focusing on things about who you are versus what you do, a lot of that you talked about just kind of comes naturally. Like you guys, you are not in the hair, you're not hairstylists, you're not barbers, beauticians, whatever word you want to call it. You are fantasy creators, you are empowerment builders. You build people's self-esteem. They come to you for a haircut, and you guys work your magic, and then they go out feeling better of themselves. So you're in the self-esteem building business, you're not in the hair business. So when you really think about that, Naomi has a huge heating and air conditioning business here in Las Vegas. She's not in the heating and air conditioning business, she's in the security business. She's in the business to secure that your home is going to be at the right temperature of what it needs to be, when it needs to be, when you come home. So, framing things that way gives not only you a better mindset, but those that are around you kind of a different perspective.
So, Ken,
as well.
That having been said, I just met you at a cocktail party, and I say, nice to meet you, what do you do?
It depends on where I'm at, you know, and again, too, it's so hard to get out of that rut. I'm in the people building business, people skills building business. I help people empower their lives, those types of answers. You know, you as a journalist, you bring news, entertainment, and laughter to those.
I'm a joy spreader.
Yes. That's it. That's the perfect line. Yeah. Yes.
Do you teach it in the schools?
I don't teach.
Have any lectures in school?
I haven't done anything in any of the schools here. I used to do a lot of stuff in Detroit before I moved here. I do a lot of corporate events. I do a lot of nonprofit organizations or that. But I haven't done anything here in Vegas in the schools.
I was just thinking, teenagers, you know.
I know, that's the goal.
Some of the young and of the disformed character.
Yeah.
I really need to hear that.
The goal of my book now, I mean, today is the official release of the book, and then from here on out, a lot of media and stuff is going to be happening, national media as well. My goal is to get this book in the hands of all parenting organizations, nonprofit organizations, the prison libraries, PTA school organizations, and those types of stuff, because it's the teachers and the parents and the business leaders that need to read the principles in this book. And to be honest with you, I am kind of brutal on teachers in this book, because there's so many of them that have no conception, just what you said, the power that they have to shape the minds of the young people that are around them, and that the teachers and parents are the two groups that really need to take to heart the job that they have to do for forming the kids' future.
Oh, look at the bullying going on.
I know.
And that, I believe in that, that your thoughts become, if you think something is true, if you believe in your head something is true, whether it's good or whether it's bad. You mentioned that too about the words that you speak. Once you put the words out there, you almost make them come true.
Right, and you can't bring them back.
I think one of the other people who really captivated me was Michelle Holmes, when he did the five people who didn't have it.
Yes.
I mean, talking about life-changing experiences. I mean, I think you look at every bit of your waking day so different after reading that book, and I can tell by some of the things that you put in your book. You know, it goes along with all of those works and premises. So, I mean, congrats to you. I mean,
and Mitch is from Detroit, too.
Yeah, you know, all of his books are just fantastic as well. But I think we're all searching for that something within us. But, boy, talking about changing your whole way you look at your day is just amazing.
It brings more peace and tranquility to you as well, too.
Right.
You're not as frantic and as stressed. You only need one glass of wine instead of
a lot. A lot of people go count their blessings, you know.
No, they don't.
Think about the good things.
And that's it too. I mean, a lot of times something happens to us and we think of it as a negative experience. But if you look at all of that as a growing adventure and think of it as like, okay. It might not be what I want to do, but I learned now not what I don't want to do anymore. So it just depends on how you look at that experience.
You have to have failure. Don't talk about it anymore.
Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
It's not about the one that they're finding. Each mistake they learn what to do differently.
Yeah, and there's a few examples of that, like Abraham Lincoln, all of his failures before he was finally elected. Failed, and some business examples in the book as well, too.
Well, when you buy the book, you're going to find that, as I said earlier, I keep it on my nightstand. Something will come about, or I'll be on the telephone speaking with someone, you know, there is something in Ken's book that applies to this situation. And I mean, my book is kind of worn out already, but you will find the same thing. And I will tell you, generosity of Ken is that portion of the sale of his book is going to benefit your Gateway Scholarship Fund. So that young people such as our gorgeous Tucson or play today will be one of them, will continue to benefit. I have a question for you. What do you think, since we do have a young person here?
What do you think about
if you describe yourself, how would you describe yourself besides being a magnificent artist?
From what I do, which like music is my passion, I also write as well. And I'm working on a novel. So,
I feel so inadequate.
So I hope that from whatever I'm doing, I can help people like release their own emotions through what I do to release mine.
Good to you.
Yes.
So I hope that helps.
And I'm going to tell you, her parents are magnificent parents. Not only supportive, but very bright in their responsibility as parents, and it's very refreshing to see.
You know, and it's the kids that hang around here with this group. We don't need to worry about that. It's the ones that aren't here that need her message, that need my book. You know, they're the ones that, because those that are here, are here for a reason and a purpose because of the energy that you know that you attract and build by putting this group together.
Which reminds me, we want to talk to Jerry about the student care center. There's a whole journey to that. There's a question in the back.
Okay, I want to know if you have any like media shows or things like that already lined up, you know, that you will be featured on.
I've been on media for years. When I was in Detroit, I was on every radio station in Detroit multiple times. I've been on TV stations. I had my own TV show in Detroit as well. Last year, I was on Good Morning America with George Stephanopoulos, and the book was in the Review Journal this past week, and now all the press releases are going out, so I think there's going to be a lot of media I'm focusing on. Because I was on Good Morning America last year, I have all those contacts with the producers, so I'm going to use that now that the book is out. So, you know, that's a good lesson. Keep your networking, keep your contacts, because you never know when you do something a year ago or 2 years ago when you can call on that favor today to even help and grow you in the future. So, yes.
I think most of the time when you tell somebody that their character has room for improvement, they will become immediately defensive and won't be open to that suggestion. And I realize this book is kind of, take a look at yourself. Is there any kind of advice that you have for perhaps subtly and yet effectively telling somebody that they might, aside from buying your book?
Just mail them, buy and mail them a copy of the book.
I don't know.
You know, it's
so many people are saying, I need, give me, and I just want to beat them.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, that probably won't change the way that they behave, and I'm just wondering if there's any kind of a way to tell them that you can do things for yourself.
Right. Or say, here's a whole other philosophy out there about, doing good and doing well for others, and then stuff will come for you. If you start focusing on those who are around you instead of focusing on just yourself, and then if you, read a book, go to this blog, or, go take this class if you're interested in it. But it is hard because people do get defensive. That's why my main message here is that parents and teachers need to start now with the young kids. Develop that so that they have that as an inherent ability within them. It's kind of hard to teach the old dog new tricks, as the old saying goes.
Isn't it true that people deep down already want to be good?
No.
Did you hear the question?
No.
Isn't it true that most people deep down really want to be good?
That all people. I mean, go talk to some of my friends that are psychologists and therapists. It's like, there's some people that have evil to the core.
I'm a sociopath.
Yeah, yes.
Well, if you're talking about, say, corporation CEOs or whatever, there's some of the people that you would like to get your book to.
Greed, money,
If you appeal to them, like, there can be a little more than that. Is that...
Well, I think with corporations it goes back to the quote from President Wilson in there about there's too many people nowadays that will not take the personal responsibility for the actions that they do within a corporation. They try to hide behind the facade of that corporation when it's actually, one or two individuals that have done all that. Thank God Bernie Madoff has gone away for as long as he is, for the crook that he is and all of the, the elderly people that, just ruin their lives forever. But he was the same way. He was trying to hide behind, his corporation, but the government nailed him and he's paying for it now. And more of that, I think, needs to happen and be publicly, known so that hopefully people will start changing the way that they think and act, when they're in powerful roles in a corporation.
Well, I read once that your parents give you your conscience, and I think so many people they do it, and you know, they don't. You know.
Yeah, but when you look at the parents today, you look at the parents today with all of these issues. I'm just that was one of the motivations for writing this book. It's like just turn on the TV and it's like, oh my God, you know, the garbage that's going on. The parents today are so young and so immature, they don't even know, they don't know these qualities, they don't know how to pass some of this stuff on. I mean, thank God that, you know, I was raised differently from that, and all of you that were in this room were raised differently.
They're not taught manners.
Right,
they know.
And so much of that has just been brushed aside.
No,
people aren't held accountable for their actions.
No, and that's what it is. The individual needs to be held accountable for their actions.
That's it.
Yes. Yeah.
I was listening to her, actually all of this, and one of my jobs, I'm a contract therapist in the jails, in the prisons, and I work with heroin addicts and domestic violence, and you know, they don't even get the concept of character defect, because many of them are just defects looking for a character, and so, you know, I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, I've used that quote, I've used that one, you know, and I'm anxious to use the book, because one of my foremost goals with them is to try to get them to realize the concept of the buck stops here. You're where you're at because of choices you've made, and it's your responsibility on every level. You are here for whatever reason for choices you've made, and the blame, you know, they all have doctors who are using blamesmanship, and, you know, that doesn't cut it with me, and so they're always mad at me.
And that was one of the issues why my friend didn't publish the book, was he didn't like the idea that I have, at the end of every chapter, I have a page of a couple like self-help questions of how to like work on yourself, and then a page of just one side page of like quotes that fit in like what we play up here. He's like, no, I said, I don't believe. He personally didn't believe in working on self-help questions and having quotes and stuff like that, and that, you know, people aren't going to buy books that's got, you know, a whole page of quotes like that in there. And I said, no, this is the way that I want to do it, and I feel that those quotes and those questions need to be in there, and they tie that whole thing together, because I want to use this as a kind of a workbook for yourself. And I do too, so that's kind of what caused that division, and you know, thank God that happened, because now I have the publishing company and all the benefits that come out of that now from here on forward.
And I want to tell you about the publishing company, because it, several people, there are a couple people right in this room who are outstanding writers and couldn't figure out what to do to publish. You know, you hear about self-publishing and all the rest. And if you speak with Ken, I will tell you, he is so kind with his knowledge, but also in guiding people to the right direction and doing the right thing and not be taken advantage of. And his own publishing company is a gift to young authors, because it is an area where you're not taken advantage of. It's really just a fabulous resource. Just through his kindness and his experiences. You know, you can do it one way. You can be greedy or you can be generous. You can start your life with one of those two G words, you know, and follow through.
And I probably could have released this book a year ago, because the majority of it was done a year ago, but it took me this past year to do all of the work of the research and laying the foundation for getting the publishing company started to then release it. So, but that extra year in delayed has actually been a blessing, because my press release that's going out to the major media, the headline is, The Book to Read Before You Vote. So with a headline like that, I think I'll be on CNN and a few of those things too, because you know what, we need to start holding our politicians accountable and our business leaders accountable. And now that this is an election year, this is a perfect time to release this book and use headlines like that to be able to then attract the media attention for the book as well. So, okay, it all ties together.
Do you have any more
questions? Yes. Will you have it available for e-readers? Actually, probably not until late this fall. And this is a whole new thing in the publishing industry with all the new e-books, the Kindles and all the Nooks and all that that are out. To be deemed bestseller status, it's still the number of physical books that you sell. They have not opened up the calculations yet to include the number of Kindle versions and Nook versions and that you sell. So as of right now, until I reach Amazon bestseller status with this, then no, I'm not going to release the e-version right now. Because you make money, but you don't get the notoriety that goes with it. And I don't want the notoriety, I want the word out there because I want more people to read the book versus putting an extra couple dollars in my pocket right now.
Speaking of getting attention, can you explain the cow from of your book?
Yes. As a matter of fact, I like cute whimsical things. I think that it attracts people's attention and it kind of lowers resistance. It's like going to a comedy club and watching Kathleen. When you're laughing or all that, your resistance is down, so you're going to have
fun. Better finish it by staying on that trial.
You're just utterly funny.
Oh, no! Oh.
So, I told my graphic designer that I want something fun, and I said, I like the cow because when you think of brand and branding something, you think of cowboys branding, you know, and cows or what they branded. So I found a picture that I really liked on the cover, and I sent it off to her. She did the cover, and then she sent that one back to me, and she sent this one back to me at the same time. It's like, oh no, it's gotta be this one because the symbology in this one is so cool because there's the old like cowboy type brand with the bars across the with character branded on the side of the cow. But when you're a person of good character and high standing, you're on top of the world and everybody looks up to you and sings your praises. And look at all the little birds here chirping and looking up at the cow. So
and the cow is happy.
Yeah, and the cow is happy. And it's bright and colorful and cheerful and all of that stuff. So yeah, I have a great graphic designer. Anything else?
Pretty great, huh? So you're seeing, this was awful to make sure that